Hello everyone, welcome to the Dr. Renuka David Wellness Show. Many of us pass through life when we are doing jobs and we are so busy that we do not spend enough time with our family, friends and close relatives. We also do a pretty mundane 9-to-6 job without having any passion in what we are doing. Also, when we do things creatively, sometimes we fail, sometimes we succeed. And if we fail, how do we deal with it? Are we ready to just brush up and get up and move? And that definitely leads to a lot of depression. Depression. How do you recognize this? Is it okay to see someone feeling depressed and not do anything about it? Today I have with me my good friend, Ms. Latha Menon. Latha is a documentary filmmaker and she has done over 100 advertisements. She is not only an excellent mother, she's an amazing wife and a very busy professional. And she's been through all these emotions. She leads a perfectly excellent work-life balance she brings into her life. She's faced failures and she's dealt with it amazingly. And then she knows what depression is all about because I guess in her field, she's seen a lot. So I'm very happy to get her on my show and let's talk on all these issues which today I feel is necessary to address to lead an extremely happy life. It's my very proud privilege to welcome you today, Latha, and have you in my show.
Thank you for having me at your show.
Absolutely. So Latha, tell me, how did it feel to work in an advertising agency and then decide to be a woman entrepreneur in 1996?
So when I joined, you know, the field was just opening up. It was pretty nascent. And we had, so there was a concept of a films department in an advertising agency and you're the head of it. And you learn how to make films and short corporates while you're working. And in most advertising agencies, they really literally, you know, how do I say, literally squeeze the juice out of you, which is a good training ground before you enter your own field. See, one doesn't know where you're heading when you start off in life, right?
Absolutely.
So that's how I began. And it was a great experience. And it also took me over. I had also joined a corporate where we were doing documentaries and shooting in chroma key, you know, like blue matte or green matte, and with a lot of graphics. So this kind of exposure kind of was like a good stepping stone for me when I could start my agency in 1996. And that primarily came about because of political changes and the government opening up the economy. Liberalization in the 1990s was a great break for people like us. Satellite television came up and advertising grew. So there was a need for advertising commercials. And that was the time that I was there. So I would say it was a great break for a person like me and opportunities came so I could set up Iris Films in 1996.
Wow, amazing. So Latha, being a very busy professional, I met your daughters the other day and you know, they simply dote on you. How has it been balancing this profession and you know, your life at home?
It's very challenging when they're growing up because you know, they want you to be around. So the great thing about the field was the flexibility also, though the timings are erratic, I also had a lot of flexibility, so I could kind of manage, and great support from home, you know, both my, from my spouse and his family, plus my mother was a big, big help. So I could just suddenly call and say, I have a meeting, Ma, I'm going to come and drop her. So I would drive down, drop my daughter, go for the meeting, then come back, pick her up, then go back to work. I would take my kids along with me to work. It's not that I just left them around the place, but they were with me, you know. And so they also grew up in the field. I didn't keep them apart, except when I went for my shoot, then obviously I had to make other arrangements. But otherwise, I was always trying to somehow juggle the kids along with me and my work. So I just took each day as it came. I never really looked long term. It was very tough for me in the initial 10 years of my life because the kids were growing and my business was growing.
Right.
So
right.
It was a big challenge, but I didn't think, you know, I just took each step. I didn't look at the big ocean really. I just saw it as one drop by next drop, and then okay, I said okay, then you have.
And you made it possible.
I made it possible because I didn't really look too far ahead.
And Latha, what do you think about, do you feel managing your time help? Do you do a to-do list before or after, or does that help in any way?
Yes, you have to be a bit planned because you know you also have to educate your kids, you've also got to plan, and you've got to make a great commercial. You have to, your brand story also has to be great, only then you'll be called for the next job. You know, like in films they say you're as known as your last hit. In your commercials you're known for the brand story that you have developed and created, and whether you've made the product sell,
right?
You know, the market right. sales, the next, so they would evaluate if their sales has grown. That means you've done a successful campaign, so you would be called again. So you know, you have to manage all that. You have numbers as well as you also have a great story to tell, and how well do you execute that story,
right?
You know, all these things go parallelly. So I did have to-do lists, but not, you know, I wouldn't meticulously follow them because it has to be in a slightly organic fashion.
Right.
But yes, I would have a larger picture in my head before I set off on what I had to, do. Yeah.
So I'm sure there were situations where you had to say a no. No. I mean, put a full stop, probably give responsibility to another to do that. But then how easy was it for you to say no?
It's tough if the client is a regular client, you know, but sometimes like certain stories like textile clients and all, I've always had it, found it challenging to do stuff for them because they were never clear about their brief. So even if you go with presentations and they just keep dilly-dallying, then I know I would not deliver a good product because there's no clarity in the brief. So I would, you know, just somehow just withdraw from such kind of executions because I know I'm not able to deliver and that's not up my market. When I'm not able to communicate beyond three or four sessions, because they'll say something, then I go back, I redo it, I go back to them, then they say something else, which is gone away from what we discussed first.
Right.
So the you know, so I used to find that tough. Then I also was, you know, certain products which you don't believe in, like, okay, it's not that I'm against people smoking or anything, but you just don't encourage,
you do not want,
you
to
know,
do
tobacco
it.
Or yeah. something like that. You yeah. don't encourage something like that, or something which will deride a female. I would not, because I am a woman director myself, so I wouldn't really, you know, partake in some commercial like that. So I've rarely done commercials which are really against, you know, which I don't enjoy projecting women as. So, you know, there are certain decisions you make when you see a script or you see a particular campaign and you say, okay, this is not up my alley. So you gently move out of it.
Move out of it.
Yeah.
And how do you believe in delegation, Latha? Or do you believe in?
Yeah, yeah, I believe in a lot of delegation. And I also walk along with them if they are totally new to the field. See, we have people who come and we really encourage people to start off on their own in our company. It's not that everyone who joins us just sticks on to us. They are with us for 3-4 years, then they generally start off their own company. So we encourage people like that. So we really train them. So we take them, initially when they come, they're absolutely novices. They would have just come with a graduate degree. The only thing I look for is the commitment when they, you know, when they come for a particular project, their commitment, their level of commitment when they're doing that project. So I'll see their physical stamina. We need a lot of stamina in our kind of work. You're constantly standing. Then your mental stamina. How are you able to work with the team? It's such a crucial thing because we work
Absolutely.
With the team, you're right?
Absolutely.
So, and we are working in very intimate spaces. We travel, we're traveling together. Mm. And you also have to be on the ball. You have to be, you know, literally your you cannot just take your eyes off the ball,
yeah.
you know, so you have to be of that mental stamina.
Right.
Then 3 is how good is your communication skill?
Absolutely.
That's also required. And how passionate are you about telling a story? So these are the 3-4 criteria that we look at in a person. So when we take a person, we observe them in one project and we notice if they are able to perform on all these particular, you know, criteria that we have set for them. And then we take them and then we hone them. They learn the skills, and in 4 years they're pretty smart to start off on their own. So we have really trained a lot of people who are doing very well in the field now.
Amazing, Latha, because that's something which people feel a little insecure, you know, parting their knowledge, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
But this is something wonderful that you're doing. It's quite inspirational yeah. because I've rarely come across people who say that, okay, I part my knowledge and I encourage people to do something which I am doing. So
yeah,
in the
yeah.
long run, they become a kind of competition for you.
They are like competition. They work with the same agencies we work with. But that's the game. So it keeps you also You know, you're literally, you're like in colleges, like professors have to present a paper with the juniors, you're doing the same thing.
So, Latha, how is stress for you? I mean, like, there's the bad stress and the good stress. So, do you like good stress or you just hate stress, or you're managing stress in your level?
If there's no stress, there's no excitement, I think. Because, see, that means you're totally excited about the field and you really want to learn. Stress comes because you want to outdo yourself, you know. And then if you're, because you're taking a little more than you can handle. But I think all of us like to do that. We like challenges. But I think you should be able to cope with it and be prepared for it. You can't just, you know, undergo stress if you do not have methods to counter it.
Absolutely.
So, you know, so suppose you don't know something about the particular film you're doing. Like, I did a documentary on a mridangam maestro. And it's not that I'm so knowledgeable about a mridangam. You know, I had to study it. I had to hang around. He's a Vidwan. Mm. So you can't speak anything stupid. But I was terribly nervous about that. And that used to add a lot of stress to my life. But fortunately, the man was a, you know, he was a very gentle soul. He just kept me by his side. And, you know, I would ask him questions. And he would partake. You know, he was not arrogant about his knowledge. Mm-hmm. I think that makes a true artist, you know.
Right.
When somebody's not true, arrogant about what they own or what they possess in terms of their knowledge or prowess. And I was able to do, he was 80 years old, the man was 80
wow.
years old. And on his 80th birthday is what we wanted to do this film.
Right.
And he was awarded a big recognition from Music Academy.
Right.
So it was a big honor for him. So we had to make a film. And
right.
You know, so it gives you the wherewithal. I think you need to be, a preparation helps you counter stress.
But stress hasn't given you sleepless nights. You deal with that.
Yeah, it's bad. Yeah, yeah. No, and every time you want to grow, yeah. it gives you sleepless nights. You know? Like you feel, okay, our field is such that there is a point when you feel that you're stagnant there. Mm. Then what do you do? How do you grow from there?
Through that.
Yeah.
So today we've just spoken on work-life balance. We've spoken on how to deal with stress. And of course, how beautifully she imparts her knowledge to others. After the break, we're going to talk to Latha and ask her how she's been in a male-dominated workplace and how she's come out on her own. So stay with us after the short break. Welcome back after this break. I'm in conversation with Latha Menon. Latha, your profession is very unconventional. You must be surrounded by so many men. So how have you handled that?
Today the scenario is different, but when I began, yes, I totally agree with what you're saying. It was quite a challenging field. It is generally more male dominated, and that's what in Cannes and the film festival this year, you had a lot of women walking on the red carpet to say that the number of film representations by women directors were minuscule compared to male. You know, so it is still a growing debate and a conversation. But when I began, yes, it was a tough thing. But I think it was a challenge. And once you ignore it, you just become thick-skinned and tough, and you just work in that field, in that scenario. And I think femininity is a kind of a strength because you bring in a different value to it.
Right.
You know, it's not just about, you know, there was a clergyman, I think, I'm not able to get the name of the person, but he said femininity is not just about lipstick, stylish hairdos and trendy clothes. It's a divine adornment of humanity. It's about your qualities, you know, about your graciousness, your creativity,
absolutely.
Your charm, your delicacy, your sensitivity, and all these qualities is what you bring in to whatever you create, you know, and what your output is. And so I totally believe in that. And even the great filmmaker that I admired, Orson Welles, whom we all studied, whose films we all, you know, try to buy heart and understand his skill in filmmaking. He was a great icon of filmmaking. He said that, you know, most artists are feminine. He can't think of the existence of an artist who's, you know, dominant personality is masculine. You know, it talks about your traits have to be feminine in order to create. You know, your dominant characteristic can't be masculine if you want to be in the creative sphere, is Orson Welles' quote.
Good. And Latha, now that you work so hard and your team puts in a great show and then it doesn't work for some reason, how do you handle this failure?
It's disappointing. We've had commercials which have, you know, like, so what happened when I did a particular story and we were working with real life people, you know, real life, not actors or models, but we were working with just real life people. And I had a certain thing and I was very protective about the way I'm going to handle the film. But I had instructed my associate, you know, I just told him about it. And I landed in the location possibly 2 hours later because I went to check something else. In the meantime, our man has gone and told the actor, who's not an actor, who's a non-actor, he's prepared him for the story.
Oh.
So the guy mugged up his lines, which he's never done in his life. And he became so self-conscious. So the whole ad just flopped.
Right.
You know, and then it was such a mistake, you know, it was such a mistake. And I was so devastated because then I snatched everything from this fellow. I was upset, but I can't show my anger.
Right.
Because I'm generally quite patient, but that literally, you know, really shook me up. And I literally snatched away and then I never shared it with anyone after that. Because we had a series of six to do. So
right.
My client was so upset with me because I had shown a test film with that actor, that particular non-actor.
Oh.
And it had worked so well because, you know, when my client was saying, you know, please work with these real life farmers, they were farmers. And I said, you don't understand, they're not going to look glamorous. It's not going to be, you know,
and this
all
poor
pretty.
Man had mugged up his life.
Yeah, the first time when I shot him, he had just spoken spontaneously from his heart. And the client loved it. So the client knows the guy is capable of a good performance. But when I went the second time around to really shoot it, he mugged up the lines and they canned the whole film, you know.
Oh.
So I felt so bad for the farmer and B for me because it was the first time I was doing it, but that's how you learn.
Learn. And then I guess you have to just pick up and get up and do it again.
I went for the next shoot the next day in some other location, but I held everything on to that. You know, this kind of mistake doesn't happen.
So was that a learning step for you?
It was a learning step.
Failure was a learning step.
Yeah,
so in a way, failure was good.
It was good,
It was good for you to teach you something new.
Yes, definitely.
So we've spoken to Latha about how she's handled failure and how she's worked in a completely male-dominant workplace. So after the break, we have many, many more interesting topics to speak on. See you after a bit. Welcome back after this break. I have with me Latha Menon, and now we're going to speak on some very, very interesting topics. Latha, you are so beautiful, but I'm sure during your work, you're surrounded by these pretty actors and models. So have you ever felt insufficient or ever felt that, oh my God, they're so gorgeous? Or have you just let your own say by your work?
Yeah, I would agree with the last line you said. Because it's work, I look at them in admiration for the character they're playing and the cast they're playing. But no, I don't go beyond and make me feel insecure.
So you never
anything.
Felt insecure?
No,
you never
no.
said, oh
I
my God, she's
like,
got gorgeous hair and she's got lovely skin. And
we admire it. We compliment them. And of course, we have to make them feel good because they have to give us the best shot, right? So I have to make the environment conducive. Right. To make them happy, because they are all actors are always in self-doubt,
right.
And are they giving the good take? So I have to make them feel confident. I have to make them feel comfortable. That is the thing. The set has to be comfortable for them to give their best shot.
Right.
So you know, and you can't bring in your personal anxieties around that to topple the whole balance.
Right.
So that is the key to.
So you, no matter how the situation is, you're always comfortable in your skin.
Yeah, I'm always comfortable in my skin, and I'm always trying to make the actors also comfortable in their skin and all the other members who are, you know, in the team.
Right.
Make each person feel
that's very important.
Important, yeah.
That's very important. Latha, you do a lot of social work. I know about your motto of giving back to the society. How important it is to give back?
See, I think everything is interconnected. I think it's only if you have that streak of empathy, are you able to also do good work? You know, it is, the thing of giving back to humanity in terms of your work as well, the kind of work that you do, it extends to, you know, monetary giving back. But I think in terms of your values, in terms of your ethics, all that I think go, you know, hand in hand with your, the other thing that you give back, you know. So in the time, in the kind of films that you make, And you can do many films for different causes. That's also another way of giving back, where you really don't, you do mostly pro bono for different causes, like you're talking right. about an issue like adoption, right. or you're talking about child abuse. So you work along with organizations like that also, apart from, you know, your other, in other capacities that you can hand back to society. Right. The way you live and the way you, you know, you do and hope well for the community, I think, is very
important. That's very important, yeah. especially when you reached yeah. there, when in your perspective that this is your success,
yeah.
it's time that you have to give back to yeah. society.
No, I think as you learn and you go along the line also, you know, because we keep experiencing and we keep meeting.
Hmm.
When you keep traveling and moving around, you keep going through different experiences, and that hmm. teaches you how to, how do you integrate these things into you, the hmm. fabric of your life as well, you know, and do as much as you can.
Mm-hmm.
In your own little way.
Latha, in your field also, there's so much of, we hear and read about depression.
Mm-hmm.
We hear wonderful actors dying of depression. I mean, you, they're so sad. And but then exterior-wise, they look so happy, so jovial. And you know, you actually envy them. They've got lovely houses, they're rich, they're famous, they've got fancy cars. But then when you go into the details, you realize that this person was depressed. And these are people who everyone aspires to become. They want to become famous. You read about Deepika Padukone. She has beauty, she's got brain, she's famous, she's rich, she's everything that anyone desires to be. But then she wakes up one morning depressed.
Yeah.
And the beauty is that she addresses it. But there are not too many people who address it. They fall prey to it and then they also commit suicide. So what is your take on depression?
Yeah. It's been an age-old thing, you know, creativity and depression seem to be going hand in hand. And earlier, nobody understood, like Vincent van Gogh, you know, the great artist
yes.
who used to be a great prolific painter.
Yeah.
He was also depressed, but there was no real support network for them and nobody understood it. See, it's something which is all internal, no, it's not like diabetes or something else where you're physically seeing a change.
Mm.
It is all internal. So you people do not, they're not able to understand it or they're not able to fathom what is going through with the person.
Mm.
Now there are groups, people are coming out, but even a person like Robin Williams, he was suffering from dementia and he couldn't come to terms with what was happening to him. Though he had the best medical treatment available to him, he had no dearth of monetary thing,
absolutely.
But it just consumed him. So it's a challenging field because you go through a lot of humiliation in our field, and so more so for actors because they are the exposed. You know, we are the viewers, we are behind the scenes, but they are the exposed. They are the ones who are vulnerable and coming in, you know, revealing it all in front of the camera. So, they're a little more sensitive and they need a little more care. They have to be treated with real delicate and, you know, kid gloves. But it, and the rejections and the humiliations someday get to you. And sometimes they're not able to cope. But a great supportive network and people who understand and care for you is the way, and if you are able to recognize your what you're going through, like how Deepika did, you know, addressed it and coming out public with it is a great thing, because it at least guides people also to do the same. If they feel and they recognize they're not okay, it's okay to not feel okay, come out with it and treat it.
Especially if a child is depressed, it's very important for the mother or the teacher
to recognize it,
it and immediately deal with it, rather than, you know, taking it in the negative manner and making the child worse.
Worse, yeah, because you think it's a social stigma, right?
Yeah.
That's what most people think it is, but it is an illness like any other.
Yeah.
And you've got to
address it.
You've got
to
address it. And
it.
Children, when they're showing signs of it, I think it's very important to immediately help them get out of it.
Very important.
Yes.
So that's a very, very strong message that do not be scared of depression and do not be ashamed of depression.
Yes.
Deal it before it gets too late.
Yep.
Yeah, that's very important. And Latha, what are your strengths and maybe your weaknesses?
Yeah, my strengths are possibly my patience, then my ability to get along with most people. I think I get along and I enjoy meeting people. And I generally enjoy a lot of music. I enjoy film. I love creating. Possibly my negative things or my, not negative things, but things that I have to work on is I tend to delay. I tend to procrastinate.
Okay.
So if I, you know, like, so I need to have a target.
Mm.
I need deadlines. I need to, so those are my, you know, why I don't sometimes don't get things done, or you know, I don't, I just let go of things, which I have to work on.
So what would be your message maybe to a budding entrepreneur, woman on budding entrepreneur, and B, someone who wants to be as creative as you but then doesn't seem to get a break? So how long does that person need to wait? Because your field is totally creative. So what I'm trying to say is you're passionate about something, and you're actually so passionate about it, though you're holding a job, maybe a 9-to-6 job, and you, it's a necessity because that kind of puts food on your table, but then you're not really passionate about it. You really want to, dealing from your present job, do something which you're so passionate about, but how long do you wait, you know, wait out? So what would be your advice?
So if you particularly like a field, like suppose you like to become a photographer, you know, a lot of people enjoy being photographers or in writing. You've got to start reading, or you've got to start seeing how a visual is taken. You've got to practice a bit in the field. And then understand if you have a flair for it. See, all of us have a flair for something. You know, most of us have an inbuilt flair, which is possibly asleep, which you've not awakened. So recognize that flair. And then go in that line where you get prepared for it. You know, you've got to read about it. You've got to spend some dedicated time to improve that flair. And then you have to start saying, okay, every day now I'm going to start doing a little about it. Like if you take, if you like writing, you have to write a little bit every day, you know, and then read. They always say that the muse is always there, but it doesn't know when inspiration strikes, but your muse is always sitting there in a chair in the corner, but it has to find you working.
Interesting.
You know, that's the line they say, you know, the muse is sitting there in the corner, but it has to find you working. Inspiration is not the only thing that is going to get you.
You
suddenly
to
today, I'm inspired, I feel like writing. You can't do that. You have to work every day. You have to write every day. You want to take pictures, you've got to see a picture every day, or you've got to take a picture every day. You've got to be at it. You know, it sounds like a, you know, okay, it's easy, but you, consciously, you have to make that effort.
Yeah, because so you've been a corporate and you stepped out because I think you weren't passionate about that, and you're doing something which you're totally passionate about.
Yeah, and also I know, to be, you know, because it's different in a corporate and all that, you have the timings and people start telling you something which you, sometimes it doesn't come to your wavelength and you're in a slightly different zone. So it helps sometimes for people like us to be working on our own, but it's tough also because sometimes you have no work. So how do you cope with periods of no work? How do you keep your mind active? You know, these are times we, you, how do you stay self-motivated? That's the key.
And you do it.
Yeah, try to do it.
But I think you're doing a great job at that, because I think you're one of the sought after advertisement makers. Thank you, Latha, for coming to my show.
Pleasure.
And going to see a lot of movies of yours.